Why is it that Russian airfields and airports are restless? There are some measures, restrictions, and no one is flying anywhere. Who will call Putin? And how can the West be motivated to help us not only with words, for example, to shoot down Russian enemy missiles and drones flying at our heads? President of Ukraine, Volodymyr Zelensky, once again reminds us of this need and requirement. We will talk about and analyze all this now. This is a live broadcast. Валерій Клочок, head of the Vesha Center for Public Analysis. Валерій, congratulations, glory to Ukraine. Friends, just 4 minutes before our conversation, the Russians launched ballistic missiles again, with threats reported from the south. Explosions have been heard in the Sumy region, and alerts have been declared in Kyiv, the Kyiv region, and central and eastern areas. We can see it live on the map. Shahids are passing Yahotin, and more ballistic missiles are flying, now targeting Pereyaslav. The Russians are bombing us, but we're not standing idle. They report over 100 Ukrainian drones launched against them last night. Meanwhile, there's unrest in Tatarstan, with the airports in Nizhnekamsk and Kazan blocked. Між тим, в Татарстані, в Казані було неспокійно. Там і аеропорт Нижнекамський, і самої Казані перекривали. And then I remembered, Valerie, that a major geopolitical event is planned for Kazan, which is being positioned by Putin, the BRICS summit. But there are, of course, different options for international politicians, such as China, not only to fly to a terrorist federation that explodes and closes airports. You know, when you were telling me this information, I could not figure out what this city is already connected with. I thank you very much, Ms. Yero, for your clear direction and for answering many questions. Yes, this is probably a kind of preparation, a groping for creating favorable conditions for all BRICS members.
Сприятливих умов для всіх учасників БРІКСу. Я не сумніваюся в тому, що зараз підуть дзвінки вже, наприклад, там із Туреччини, яка планує туди полетіти, із Пекіну.
Тому що I have no doubt that now we will receive calls, for example, from Turkey, which is planning to fly from Beijing, because China has confirmed its participation in the BRICS summit, and other countries will ask us not to hit or shell them, at least for this period, when they are going to be there. But, you know, I'm not sure it will be that easy for those who call the office of the President of Ukraine to negotiate this. I have no doubt that there will be such contacts. To be fair, I must say that the Russian air defense system is working. They shoot down both drones and incoming missiles. We shouldn't underestimate the work of the S-400, S-300, and there are newer systems. They can even shoot down ATACMS ballistic missiles. But one of them, according to the General Staff of the Armed Forces of Ukraine, did reach somewhere today. What's noteworthy is that we don't have information on where the relevant complex was destroyed. I've looked for details, but haven't found anything either, only that it was reportedly destroyed using ATACMS, according to an official report from the headquarters. It seems the Nibo-M radar station has been hit, but the general staff hasn't confirmed this yet. Both my subscribers and yours are curious about when official permission for such information will be issued. Nikiforov, the spokesman for the President of Ukraine, said that the Russians would be the first to know about it. So apparently, they have learned about it. Wow, but I think that the General Staff shouldn't comment on this in the future, even if the Kremlin is in some uncertainty, at least strategically and tactically. And this whole attack was carried out in order to provide an air corridor for the effective use of the already cruise missiles, Storm Shadow and Scalp. Again, this is an official report from the General Staff, so I see that events can develop very interestingly in Russia. Of course, we want the maximum result, which is the liberation of all territories from the occupation forces of Ukraine and Crimea, including, of course, Russia is actively preparing to defend the Kerch Bridge, building various kinds of defensive structures there and so on, and understands that the attacks will continue, of course, personally. Of course, I personally would really like to see more attacks on Russian territory, shown by drones, even if they are shot down. This will significantly deplete Russia's air defense system and force the Russians to build their plans in a completely different way in the future. If all this news comes in parallel with other statements from countries other than our partners, let's say, countries that are neutral towards Ukraine, such as Saudi Arabia, have announced potential measures that may lower oil prices to $50, which could have a significant impact on us. For now, I remain cautiously optimistic as we monitor developments that seem favorable. Meanwhile, the Russians are preparing for potential challenges, having tested air raid alarms in several regions, including Moscow and Krasnodar. It's difficult to predict their next moves, especially as the Ukrainian president seeks permission to strike targets beyond 300 kilometers. My colleagues and I discussed this at the Tower Center for Public Analysis, noting that our ambitions are growing justifiably. I'm pleased that we are taking cues from Israel and often disregard advice from our Western partners regarding actions on Russian territory.
Наших західних партнерів, як нам діяти на території Росії.
Just yesterday, the newspaper published an intriguing article stating that the United States is facing a serious problem. It cannot cope with either the Prime Minister of Israel or the President of Ukraine, Volodymyr Zelensky, in their efforts to build a different way of organizing events in the theater of operations in Ukraine and the Middle East.
Тому що Сполучені Штати Америки виступали послідовно проти наземної операції Ливану.
United States initially opposed Israel's ground operation in Lebanon and the destruction of targets in Beirut and its vicinity, as well as a ground operation in the Kursk region. Increasing information suggests that responsibility for these actions has shifted to Ukraine, which is a positive development for us.
Зараз є інформація про це, і мені це вказує на те, що вся відповідальність була перекладена на Україну, і добре, що ми там маємо успіхи.
Moscow recognizes that their situation won't solely depend on our partners restraining our capabilities on the front and in strikes against Russia. We must not underestimate the enemy. While Russia is a vast country, its cooperation with
Я наголошу, не можна недооцінювати ворога, бо ми часто так вважаємо, що та ж тільки там тієї Росії. Це, по-перше, велика країна, але, по-друге, треба розуміти, що на сьогоднішній день залишається великою проблемою можливість співпраці Росії.
Other nations pose significant challenges, especially regarding intermediaries to bolster their defenses. Their testing of air systems indicates preparation for potential strikes from Ukraine. I thank Representative Miller for saying, okay, you can hit. No one has denied you the right to hit with your own weapons. Thank you, and we thank you. Signal, yes, it's a good story, but here's a question. We don't have that many weapons, so they could help us. Because in this part, I was very interested in the comment of the new NATO Secretary General, Mark Rutte, who said that we should invest in Ukraine because it is our security. But now the situation is such that the countries of the North Atlantic Alliance are confused by the events that are happening in Ukraine. The Croatian president blocked the government's initiative to join a new NATO-backed security service to support Ukraine, stating he doesn't want to promote it. He emphasized that Croatia will continue its assistance to Ukraine, as it has in the past, without participating in this new process.
Просувати Хорватія не буде долучена до цього процесу до допомоги Україні. Ми будемо допомагати так, як допомагали. Але
I was struck by the comment yesterday by the Croatian president who blocked the decision the initiative, let's say, of the Croatian government to join the newly created security service to support Ukraine, which is being created within the framework of the North Atlantic Alliance and other countries. This is an alternative to Ramstein, which will work next year. And he says, you know, I don't want to make this decision to promote it there. Croatia will not be involved in this process, in helping Ukraine. Croatia will continue its assistance to Ukraine as before, despite being a NATO member, which sends a concerning signal as the war spreads to Europe. We shouldn't underestimate Putin's determination to achieve his goals, and they are preparing for a defensive response. Their testing of an air defense system does not alarm me, as it indicates their preparations. Але ми не будемо до цього причетні. То вина Путіна. Тобто ми отдельно, а Путін отдельно. The Kremlin maintains a consistent policy of acclimating Russians to perpetual war. In 2022, after the partial mobilization announcement, there were significant protests in Moscow, St. Petersburg, and other major cities, where many expressed their dissatisfaction with being drafted and preferred to avoid participation in the conflict. Але все ж таки повернуся до початку нашої розмови. Історія з Казанню тут якраз більш далекоглядний момент, який Іра, я That is Putin's fault. That is, we are separate. And Putin is separate. And now we are not. So now everyone is involved in this process. Indeed, we talk a lot about how this will somehow stir up the Russian population, that they will be unhappy with these alarms. But no, I don't see this yet. Rather, Moscow is now demonstrating that it is preparing for such strikes and will continue the war, as I see it so far. But still, to return to the beginning of our conversation, the Kazan story is just a more far-sighted point that I share with you. It will be a serious wake-up call for all of Russia's partners, as evidence that if you are going to fly to Russia, you should do it very carefully. And it is better to agree with Ukraine that we are not shelling this or that airfield at that moment. Or not. You can just take a train, just like Kim Jong-un is doing. Can the BRICS now aim to turn this alliance into a more, so to speak, power and security alliance as an alternative to NATO, as they imagine, in order to strengthen their influence in this Eurasian, more Asian part of the world, or not? Or will it still be more about politics and money? You know, when people started talking about BRICS in general, it was about a year and a half or 2 years ago in Ukraine. Many of my colleagues have said, you know, I've heard a lot of comments that you pay attention to this BRICS. A London economist came up with this structure. Well, it's true. The countries that he conventionally named that could have united did unite. Well, they did. And today the BRICS is expanding with 9 countries, if I'm not mistaken, in terms of population, a very powerful bloc, and also in terms of economy. It should not be underestimated, and the fact that even a NATO country, Turkey, wants to join it. As you said, there will be such a meeting in Kazan at the end of the month. So this opens up very serious prospects for the BRICS. Of course, I would be disingenuous if I said that there is monolithicity there. No, there is not. Because India and China are two countries that will never put up with each other. Moreover, they have territorial claims. My colleagues and I have been working on this topic within the center, and there are those who join our center who are quite well-known experts in the field of the Chinese case and India, among others. And we have come to the conclusion that at this stage, there are two currents emerging in BRICS, one from India and one from China, which want to monopolize something. But to have a majority to make the relevant decisions within this economic bloc. While reports suggest that the BRICS bloc is considering forming a military wing, it's important to note that India and China, despite their overlapping interests in regions like East Asia and the Pacific, will not cooperate militarily. Their differing goals and competitive dynamics make it unlikely for BRICS to become a military alliance. While it may seem premature to dismiss the potential for BRICS to evolve, it's crucial to recognize the indirect influence of North Korea on China's relationships with Russia and other nations. North Korea's consistent push for inclusion in the alliance could pose a significant threat to global stability. Evaluating the prospects of BRICS should be done cautiously, as they may present challenges for the world. This context has prompted active cooperation among Australia, Japan, the US, and India, highlighted by a recent summit where leaders made significant statements. They also cooperate in the military sphere. If the West succeeds, let's say, in luring India out of this bloc, it will not be easy, because India is interested in cooperation with Russia. In particular, it has a significant dependence on payments in the national currency, the rupee. Today, relatively speaking, Russia is owed about $35 to $40 billion in rupees, which the Russians cannot do anything with. Instead, India is saying, if you have a problem, you can invest in the Indian economy. This is a very classic move on its part. As for military cooperation, if the Western countries do manage to knock India out of the possible military wing of the BRICS, it will be a partial success, but we cannot rule out the scenario of a military bloc based on the BRICS. This is indeed a very serious challenge to the stability of the entire world today. Thank you, Valery. We will take these risks into account and discuss them as well, and we hope that the whole world will be able to show even greater determination and help us fight Russian aggression if it starts helping to shoot down missiles with Western weapons and Western air defense systems. This is what Zelensky said in his address to Ukrainians and the world the day before. Let's have a quick listen. What the guarantor reminds partners of and motivates them to do, and then discuss how realistic it is. Last night, the Russian army launched another attack on Ukraine with Shaheds. There were hits in Odessa region, in Izmail district, and near the Romanian border. The rebels hit ordinary civilian infrastructure, the ferry terminal, on trucks, on grain warehouses, the very thing that Russian terrorists always perceive as a target, the food security of the region and the world. Ukraine has long been telling all of its neighbors, all of its major partners, that we need to cooperate, that we need to shoot down chess pieces and missiles together, and that this is absolutely possible in areas that are close to NATO countries. During the criminal Iranian strikes, we see the international coalition acting together. I thank every state that helps us with air defense. I thank Romania in particular for Patriot, and we can achieve even greater effectiveness. We can put an end to Russian terror by shooting down chess pieces, missiles in cooperation. Valery, what really keeps you from doing this? Is it a matter of self-defense, not an attack on Russia? You know, the answer here is too simple, but it will help us move the Ukrainian issue forward. The head of Estonian Defense Ministry said Estonia had discussed sending military contingent to Western Ukraine for soldier training and military functions. However, as noted in Estonia, this is impossible at this stage, as a consensus decision must be made within the North Atlantic Alliance to send a limited contingent of troops to Ukraine. And in this way, Estonia is simply shifting responsibility to NATO. In Estonia, it is easier and harder, with its own challenges and advantages. So far, no air targets from Russia have reached Estonia, although there have been some in Latvia, so they could reach Estonia. Estonia is literally one step away from a possible hybrid attack, or perhaps even an outright conventional attack against Narva, as Putin has repeatedly said. They recognize they may not be primary targets if Russia escalates aggression against NATO. In response to drone and missile threats, especially to the Bucharest 9, these nations have urged NATO to reconsider intercepting air targets over Ukraine and their territories. It's perplexing that a NATO member would hesitate to act while under fire, as the missile's trajectory, lost or off course, doesn't change the situation. In this context, I would like to recall the story of the downing of a Russian fighter jet by Turkish Air Defense Systems, when it was clearly told to the Russians that, if again, we will remind you where the Turkic world is, and we will reclaim it. Russia immediately put it in reverse and never did it again. The story with Eastern Europe is similar. Unfortunately, the policy of the North Atlantic Alliance until 2022 did not provide for any such policy at all, to be honest. The possibility of causing any damage to a potential enemy on its territory or to cause damage on its territory after the aggression has begun. In this case, Estonia again made a statement. Recently, Estonian intelligence has been issuing a lot of statements, which indicates that they understand, know, and have some certain data that an attack may be being prepared against them, which is how I perceive it. They indicate that if Russia were to attack them, they would target military facilities involved in such operations. This marks a significant shift in NATO's strategy, which emerged after the Madrid summit in 2022, but is only now being discussed. Let's consider for a moment what NATO's strategy entails if they are just now formulating a response following the onset of Russia's large-scale invasion. They decided that Ukraine could strike Russian territory, a shift from their previous stance. This raises questions about what missiles might be involved, given the ongoing war. Our resilience has convinced NATO of the need for change, but I don't foresee a swift decision-making process within the alliance. The United States plays a crucial role in defending against air attacks. On the territory of Romania, Poland, the Bulgarian army, and all Eastern European countries, all without exception. Like to see NATO's policy change in this regard. However, given the slowness and spinelessness of the North Atlantic Alliance, I cannot say otherwise, because this alliance cannot be underestimated, but there are very serious flaws. European Union is exploring the creation of its own troops to help repel potential Russian attacks on NATO territory. It is no coincidence that the Croatian president emphasized that the war goes beyond Ukraine. Russian-Ukrainian war is extending beyond Ukraine's territory. This poses a risk for Europe, as Ukraine and its European partners may eventually establish a new military and political bloc that operates independently of Washington and Berlin. The question remains about the capabilities of the defense systems available, many of which are imported and come with conditions for use. This situation presents significant challenges for the alliance, hindering its ability to counter aggression effectively.
Є там певні умови їх використання. Це величезна проблема альянсу, який серйозно сьогодні стримує його можливості.
Valerie, one more question. We literally have up to 5 minutes. Scholz wants to talk to Putin, but at least he has this desire from time to time.
поки той живий ніякою табакеркою, чорним лебедем чи збройними силами його не прибрали, Шольц поговорити з Путіним, але принаймні таке бажання в нього періодично виникає.
Federal government spokesperson Stefan Gebright explains that Scholz is ready to call the Kremlin leader only when it is appropriate. He has not done so since December 2022, if that makes sense. Scholz himself comes out and says, Putin should not hope that he can swallow Ukraine. The German chancellor assures that Ukraine will receive a $50 billion loan from frozen Russian assets and that support for Ukraine from international allies will remain stable and will not weaken in the near future. The Kremlin is probably waiting for someone from a civilized country to call them. Peskov says that no one has requested any call, but they are watching. What does this mean? Scholz says there will be support, but he is not averse to talking to the other side. What is the point of talking to Putin at all? Wait, we saw Orban go to talk to Putin and visit Ukraine. We condemned it, but it happened. We saw how Modi spoke with Putin, then came to us. We didn't condemn Modi for this. You know, I would have taken this information calmly, especially given that Germany provides the largest amount of aid to Ukraine in all of Europe. More than the French and even the British put together, and this support will continue. So the fact that Scholz will call Putin will not change his position. The question is that we are moving towards the Peace II summit announced by Zelensky, where the Russian side should be present. The format and venue are still unclear. China wants to gather it. It is preparing an alternative venue, perhaps even in Beijing. Brazil, Hungary, Switzerland have already joined this initiative. Perhaps even France will join. And Germany would also like to be involved in this process, especially since the head of the Scholz party has proposed the creation of a negotiating group from China and Brazil to, well, launch this process. Why shouldn't Germany, for example, join? Olaf Scholz also wants this. I do not rule out the possibility that he will talk about the possibility of Putin's participation in the G20 summit in Brazil at the end of November, where leaders of countries could meet and talk with Putin in the G20 format, including about Ukraine. According to Kirill Budanov, head of the main intelligence agency, a key problem remains that many countries, including those in Western Europe and nearly all G20 nations, continue to supply Russia with microchips and components needed for missile production. This ongoing support poses a threat to Ukraine. Instead of seeking dialogue with Putin, we should establish conditions for him, making it clear that failure to comply will have consequences. And we are already demonstrating that, as you rightly pointed out, alarm sirens are sounding, so far in a test mode, all over Russia. But this means that Russia can get a serious kick in the nuts. First of all, Putin and his entire population, who will be extremely unhappy with the fact that chessmen and missiles are flying at their heads. Perhaps even the chessmen will turn around because our military is already developing the appropriate technologies. And all this can be a very serious challenge for him. And in any case, this contact must take place. I do not rule out that Scholz is ready to take such an initiative, especially since there are so many people who want to be in the negotiation process. Even the aforementioned Saudi Arabia has also stated that it is ready to mediate in such negotiations. Valery, thank you for the conversation, and I'll see you tomorrow. Thank you for your position. Take care of yourself. See you soon. Have a nice day. Valery Kloshok, head of the Center for Public Analysis, VESHA. Thank you for your activity. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Take care. Believe in the armed forces of Ukraine. See you, and let's win.